just lovely. So wonderful to be together in community, so wonderful to be together in church today and to listen to Sanctuary Collective as they bring the message of the Christmas. Oh gosh, it's just so exciting. Well, welcome to everyone present with us today. Welcome to all of our friends on Zoom. We're so pleased that you're with us today. And now, if you are able, please stand and join with me in the call to worship. Praise be to God, who has given God's light to us. Honor and praise to God for God's most precious gift. The darkness that enveloped the light has been pierced by the light. Let us rejoice in God's blessed goodness. Let us continually praise God with great joy and thanksgiving. Amen. And please remain standing if you are able as we join together in singing our opening hymn, Joy to the World. Our first reading this morning is from Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7, the purpose of the law. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Our second hymn is Away in a Manger. Please stand if you are able. Pray for the church, for those of us who gather in this place and all who call sanctuary their church. However we join together, let any distance that separates us geographically never be a distance in our spirits. Instead, please knit us together as we pray, sing, and encounter you, even while miles apart. Lord, have mercy. Lord, we pray for the world, this beautiful and wounded and delightful home that you've created. We thank you for the incomparable beauty of the created world, and we offer ourselves as stewards and caretakers, preserving its beauty and its diversity for future generations. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the suffering among us. We hold before you both the joy and the terror of being alive in this world, the wounds and bruises that mark each one of us. We pray for healing, hope, and comfort, both as we suffer and as we celebrate. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for those we have loved who are no longer with us. We grieve the caverns in our hearts left by their absence. And we ask for you and your love to stitch us back together day by day as we mourn. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we now join together in the prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If you will bear with me for a moment, I want to share a particularly poignant Christmas gift from this year. Everything that we've been together since we met in February came together when my son handed me a bag yesterday that had this in it. And as we met while grieving, all of us, Michigan State, and sent my son off, and it just was a neat circle yesterday to have that. And I didn't think I could wear it, so I thought I'd at least share it with you that way. Excuse me. Our text for today is perhaps not as often heard as it should or could be, but it takes us to Luke's gospel and picks up from where we left off last Sunday in the 22nd verse of chapter 2. When the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice, according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves, or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too. There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband for 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. Amen. Let's pray together. Dear God, may the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, for you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So our two texts for today continue us in the Christmas story, each in their own way. We talked a little bit last week. Mark has no time for Christmas. In Mark, Jesus is 30, and how he got there isn't as important as what he's going to do next. Luke is where we build most of our creche. In Luke, we get Mary, and we get angels, and we get shepherds, and we get animals in a manger, and we get no room in the inn. And then in Matthew, we get Joseph, who has to come to terms with this and realize that he is a part of this plan too. And then John the poet, John the dreamer, John who wants us to know that Jesus always was, and that he was on earth for a little while, and that he always will be. This is the birth story according to Paul. Came to earth, born of a woman. That's it. That's Christmas all over again. That's our recap of last week from Paul. But in telling that story, in telling the story again of Jesus coming to earth as an infant and growing as a child, Paul invites us to own our own child status as children of God. That we are children of God, and not just children, but heirs. That we are a part of something so much larger than ourselves. That we are children of God, and that image of coming to God like a child, that image of owning our childlike nature, not necessarily our childish nature. Paul said elsewhere that he set aside childish ways. But he invites us to remain childlike and to live our faith in a childlike way. When I think about that, I think of an old story about Karl Barth. Karl Barth, a German theologian who wrote dozens and dozens of books. His primary work was something called Church Dogmatics, which is four volumes, to a seminary student, weighs several tons. Just huge, huge four-volume set of everything he could think about what he knew. The story says he was speaking. He was either at the University of Chicago or at the seminary in Virginia that's in Richmond, or maybe both. And he had a question and answer period after he spoke, and somebody raised their hand and said, "Can you summarize everything that you believe in one sentence?" And he said, "I can. I learned it at my mother's knee when I was a child. Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so." There's various legends about this story, but there were witnesses who say that it is true, and it appears it may have happened in more than one place, and so perhaps Dr. Barth wanted to answer that question. For me, it doesn't make a difference. The important thing about it to me is that a man who could write this much stuff, pounds and pounds, thousands and millions of words about faith and what it means, could still boil it down to one single sentence. That he didn't have a faith that became complicated, but a simple faith that became deeper and richer and deeper and richer. but still the power of a simple faith, of moving through life with a faith that can speak to any situation. To be condemned and to be able to respond, but Jesus loves me. This I know. To be celebrated and honored and rewarded, and remember that at your core you are a child of God, still at your mother's knee, still singing a beautiful and simple song. It is the power of having faith that is clear and is portable and then deepens and enriches as we go through life. Your prayer request says that better than anything I put on this card or any other piece of paper. Things you've done many times that mean something totally different now. Thank you, and we love you. I also love this story from Luke. Luke, who wanted to be accurate, who wanted to give us details. And he gives us details about Joseph and Mary doing what they were supposed to do. They were following the rules. It was time. And so they took Jesus and they went to the temple. We've all done things like this. I have to be there at 10:15 because it starts at 10:30 and I've got to do the thing. And then after the thing, well, I'm going to do something else. But they went to do this simple task, ready for anything. Now, they'd already been through a lot. Mary was told that she was favored by being pregnant and unmarried, and she pondered what that meant. She had carried a child and delivered a child, not under the care of anybody medical or anybody family, but in a manger. And Joseph had thought that maybe he would do the dignified thing and he would let Mary go away quietly. And instead, here he is, the father of a child, presenting that child in the temple. But they were doing what was expected. They were following the rules. But they were willing to experience more. They arrived not just dutifully, but with hearts wide open, with minds wide open, with eyes and ears to see and hear what would happen when they came in and paid the poverty rate of 2 turtle doves. For if they had any more, then the sacrifice was actually much larger. But they didn't have anything except 2 turtle doves and this child. And they walked in to present that child. And Simeon, who we don't know exactly how old he is, we do know almost to the day how old Anna is, but he is a seasoned human being. He's been around for a while. And he walks in and he walks up to them and he takes their baby. And he begins to talk about this baby and what this baby means, what it means to him who has waited his whole life to understand that God sent a Messiah. And now he holds that Messiah in his hands, cuddles that Messiah to his chest, bears that Messiah in the middle of this ceremony and transforms it with the power and message of God's gift and God's grace. Simeon lived with expectation that there was more yet to come, that promises would be fulfilled, that he would indeed be the witness that he was told he would be. And as Mary and Joseph arrived, open to what was to happen before them. He arrived, like he arrived everywhere, with expectation that God's promises might be fulfilled. And they were in that moment. Then he foretold the good and the bad, that Jesus would be the source of controversy and that Mary's very soul would be pierced. Then Anna, 84 years old, has lived in the temple for decades, cared for as a precious widow, like we would also care for a precious orphan. She is at home there, and she enters and sees the scene, and she begins to rejoice. She is a prophet. She is a prophet. And like Elizabeth and like Mary and like many more women that we will meet in the course of Luke's gospel, she is a powerful and important female voice about the wonder and power of God. She is able to be aware of what's happening in front of her. She brings an awareness in the same way that Simeon brings his expectation, and in the same way that Mary and Joseph established themselves as being ready for whatever was going to take place as they dedicated their oldest child to the glory of God. We all go through rituals. We all have moments. If we participate in them right, they are transforming and powerful. We know this. We know this because we transformed this baptistry and filled it. And like human beings, we bailed underneath it. Perhaps most of you don't know that. But we also experience the wonder and power of baptism by water and baptism through the moving of the Holy Spirit. And we rejoiced because we were ready and willing and able. Simple ritual can sometimes be something to get through, something to complete, a task to check off a list. But the rituals that we practice as people of faith have the power to transform. And as we look at what we do and how we do it, that to me is the measure. We want to be so much more than going through the motions, but to be full participants in the movings of God, even when we're doing something that we've seen and heard hundreds of times before. We are children of God. That makes us brothers and sisters, one to another, but so much larger than that makes us brothers and sisters with all whom we meet and those who we don't, those who we may read about or hear about or reflect on. We are part of something, and taking that awareness with us into the world can help us transform the world by that fact transforming us in the first place. We are heirs of God. We are co-participants in the building up of this kingdom. So our community, which brings us together as part of a family that calls us into service, not for those who are not of us, but for more people who are of us, it is our opportunity to live in expectation. It is our opportunity to embrace the power of being children of God. It is our opportunity to move into something that is described on paper in one way, but may be filled with so much more through God's powerful presence. Jesus loves me and you. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Father Abraham had many sons. Many children had Father Abraham, and I am one of them, and so are you. So let's all praise the Lord. When I am in God and God is in me, I have peace like a river. Someday I'll tell you the story of my friend Joy Hart, but for today, I have the joy down in my heart to stay. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. And they that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. That song taught me that scripture, 1 John 4, 7, and 8. Even the quote is in the song. Most especially, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine, and let it shine, and let it shine, and let it shine. On Christmas Eve, when we welcomed a glorious crowd, we went to let our light shine, and we learned that some weren't prepared. If you were watching on Zoom, you may not have realized that people back there were literally in the dark. But we found the light, and we brought it to them, thanks to Jordan and others. And then we shared that light, and we spread that light, and we brought that light into the world with us, not in tiny candles, but in the power of the word of Christ. May that word dwell in you and in me and in us richly in 2024 and forevermore. Amen.
Strong and good, was humbly born in a stable room, and the friendly beasts around him stood. Jesus, our brother, strong and good. I said the dawn. My mate and I said the dog.
Would you now join me in reciting the generosity prayer as found in your bulletin? Godliness with contentment is great gain. We bring nothing into this world and we take nothing out of it. We who call Jesus Lord devote ourselves to resisting greed, which plunges the human heart into ruin and pierces it with many griefs. We are determined to practice generosity with free hearts, fixing our hope on God and not the uncertainty of wealth. We desire to be rich in good deeds, willing to share all that we have, laying up for ourselves treasure that will not decay, but will shine in the age to come. May it be true of our community. Amen.
May the love of God fill us with childlike wonder. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ bring us shoulder to shoulder, face to face, hand in hand with the world in need. May the power and strength of the Holy Spirit inspire, equip, unite, and guide us this day and forevermore. To God be the glory. Amen.